Okay, so as I've mentioned, the topic of input and output is so broad that I've split it into two lectures. I hope we can get through this part today. Organizational stuff, I think most of it should be pretty clear. Next exercise sheet is due on Friday. There won't be any physical lectures in here for the next 2 weeks, but I'll upload them to YouTube. Then there will be a tutorial on the 13th, where we'll present the papers for the projects. I think I've already mentioned that I'll try to bring them some really recent ones from CAI, where I'll be for the next 2 weeks. And on the 20th, we'll start with the project, and the regular lecture will continue again on the 25th. All right, so let's look at I/O again. And today, in this part, I'd like to focus on vision for input and output, on speech, and on other even more weird, let's call it weird, I/O channels. So first of all, let's look back at one issue, and that is that of bimanual interaction. So we have different ways of interacting with the device using two hands. We can have symmetric interaction where I use both hands in the same way, like for example for typing. Bimanual asymmetric interaction would be holding it in one hand, for example, and typing with the other. And unimanual interaction would be simply holding it in one hand and also using it with one hand because I need to use the other hand for something else. Again, I'd like to talk about a few research projects which try to address this topic. First one is called micro roles. These are gestures which you can execute only with your thumb. So this is mostly aimed towards unimanual interaction when you don't have any, when you basically can just use your thumb. And the idea is that you push down and move your thumb in different directions or even make a circle. And when the recognition works well, then it basically gives you 6 additional commands which you can execute just with your thumb. So different context operations like moving things or copy and paste and so on. So all of this should then be reachable with a single hand. Again, the problem here is that why don't we see this in common devices? It looks very straightforward, and it might actually be very helpful if you just have one hand. So what do you think? Why is this not commonly used? Any ideas? Yeah? Like to maybe not take the most straight route, but look around a little. So also a way of using motion as a side channel in a way. If you think that even farther, then you get to an even more active version of that, and that would be using the user itself or moving the user itself. That's actually possible. So what you can see here at first sight, it looks like just headphones, but they actually have electrodes integrated. And they can use that to more or less steer the user, because if you apply a small current to the inner ear, even through the skin, then you get the inner ear is what you use for sensing tilt. And this small current, even if I'm standing perfectly still, then I would get the idea or the sense that I'm tilting to the right. And then what I will, of course, do is move to the right so I don't fall over, because I'm getting the impression that everything is tilting. And then I would, to compensate that, I would move a little to the right, of course. Well, that's not something which many people will accept outright. So this is a little more speculative, but it's still possible. And one application area where this actually would make a lot of sense is in virtual reality. So that you can give people a better sense of immersion into the virtual world and that you can also steer them around. Maybe you've seen this, some virtual environments already use what's called redirected walking, so that you can walk for a far longer direction than what you actually have space. So it kind of subtly steers people in circles while giving them the impression that they're actually walking straight. And something like this might be used to help with that. So in a sense, this is also using motion as output, and it's actually moving the user itself. Yes?
I think it has also, because I've heard Professor Walsh, and he said also that it has medical concerns.
Of course, yeah. So you need to make sure that it's only battery powered. So usually, as soon as you connect something to the proper power supply, then you need a lot of protection built in to make sure that the user doesn't get an electric shock, basically. So if it's just battery powered, then it's mostly safe, but still you it can, if you have someone who maybe has some kind of illness with the ears or something, then it may he or she may be more sensitive, so it's really difficult to get this right, I guess. But still, it might be something we may see in future virtual reality headsets, for example. There's another example related, which I also find quite interesting. This is called muscle-propelled force feedback. This is a little more straightforward. So as you can see here, that guy has two electrodes on their forearm, and they're connected to the mobile device and the game running there. And what this game now does is trigger an electric current through those electrodes, and that will cause the arm to contract, basically. And because you're not doing that on your own, but it's triggered externally, what you get is the impression that the phone is actually pushing you down, and that you have to push back. So and that can be used for force feedback in the game. So it really feels like that the phone is getting much heavier or pushing, but in fact it's just your own arm which is contracting. But since you're not doing that on purpose, because it's not basically triggered by your own decision, then it feels like that the device is actually pushing down. And again, of course, you get safety issues. It must be battery powered. It can actually hurt, I think, quite a lot if you get too much power through the electrodes, because then it's like you get a cramp in the hand or in the arm. So this is also not something which is already suitable for any kind of mass market application. But it's, again, it's an idea which you may be able to use in a specific context, and which actually works quite well as far as I know. So you don't actually need that much power to trigger this contraction, and these electrodes are usually quite safe. But still, for some people it may at least hurt if it's too much power. So still, you probably, if you ever test something like this on people, then you would probably need to sign a lot of paperwork before you're actually allowed to test that. All right. Then one final and very weird concept I'd like to briefly mention, at least. This is the work from Fabian Hemmert. He's done a lot of similar stuff. And here the idea is that also to use motion as output. And in this case, the device itself will move in some way. So for example, it will have some regular motion, like it's breathing. And the more messages you get, the quicker and more hectic that motion will get. So you get the idea that you're phone is basically stressed out and you should answer your messages. Or you get this one other variant was a phone that was getting thicker and thicker as you put in more data. And the more storage space you use, the thicker the phone gets. So also some kind of metaphor for real world scenarios transferred to the phone. Of course, that would need a lot of power, and it would be pretty complex to build this into a regular phone. As you can see here, this prototype is just a shell, more or less. Again, it's an idea, a weird one, of course, but maybe it's suitable as a kind of inspiration for other scenarios. So, mostly just here for reference. Okay, so to summarize all this motion stuff we talked about. Can have motion input. Usually, that's done by just sensing where the device is using those micro electromechanic sensors. This time I got it right. And we can also use motion as an input by sensing different things about the user. Or we can use motion as output. In common devices, that's just one single channel using vibration at most, but there's different kinds of research ideas floating around of how you could use motion in a different way, maybe by even moving the user themselves. All right, so that's what was left over from last week. Are there any more questions or comments up to here? Okay, so let's continue with today's actual stuff. That would be this one. Okay, so as I've mentioned, the topic of input and output is so broad that I've split it into two lectures. I hope we can get through this part today. Organizational stuff, I think most of it should be pretty clear. Next exercise sheet is due on Friday. There won't be any physical lectures in here for the next 2 weeks, but I'll upload them to YouTube. Then there will be a tutorial on the 13th, where we'll present the papers for the projects. I think I've already mentioned that I'll try to bring them some really recent ones from CAI, where I'll be for the next 2 weeks. And on the 20th, we'll start with the project, and the regular lecture will continue again on the 25th. All right, so let's look at I/O again. And today, in this part, I'd like to focus on vision for input and output, on speech, and on other even more weird, let's call it weird, I/O channels. So first of all, let's look back at one issue, and that is that of bimanual interaction. So we have different ways of interacting with the device using two hands. We can have symmetric interaction where I use both hands in the same way, like for example for typing. Bimanual asymmetric interaction would be holding it in one hand, for example, and typing with the other. And unimanual interaction would be simply holding it in one hand and also using it with one hand because I need to use the other hand for something else. Again, I'd like to talk about a few research projects which try to address this topic. First one is called micro rolls. These are gestures which you can execute only with your thumb. So this is mostly aimed towards unimanual interaction when you don't have any, when you basically can just use your thumb. And the idea is that you push down and move your thumb in different directions or even make a circle. And when the recognition works well, then it basically gives you 6 additional commands which you can execute just with your thumb. So different context operations like moving things or copy and paste and so on. So all of this should then be reachable with a single hand. Again, the problem here is that why don't we see this in common devices? It looks very straightforward, and it might actually be very helpful if you if you just have one hand. So what do you think? Why is this not commonly used? Any ideas? Yeah? Yeah, but swiping is, at least from my opinion, swiping is quite difficult to do with one hand. So,
those gestures, they're not contradictory, sort of.
That's maybe one problem, that they actually contradict other operations. Please.
Okay. Because usually you hold it not like this, but like this. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, that's a good point. Maybe the stance of the finger is a bit artificial in this example.
I think the region which like this thumb is mm-hmm. active, which is small, like you cannot do this gesture like for example at the top of the screen.
Yeah, that's a good point. You can't reach the entire screen usually. It might also be a reason that this needs to be also uses some kind of, in the widest sense, some kind of machine learning. And usually you need to train that, and then it's trained for one single user. And that's something most people don't want to do in the first place. So all of these might be reasons why we don't see that in common devices. Regarding bimanual interaction in general, there's an interesting study which I'd like to mention, which deals with how people actually do bimanual interaction when they're actually forced to do unimanual interaction. So if you basically hand them an object which they can't drop, and how do they use that, how do they incorporate that into their device usage. So interesting is, for example, here E, where they actually use the device itself to the interfering device to push some buttons or something like that. And this is where we kind of have to look at the topic of context again, because something like the scenario in E isn't possible if you're holding a coffee mug, because then you might spill coffee over your mobile device. So it's very much dependent on the context. And if you're designing a mobile interface, so it's probably not possible to take all of these into account. But I think the important takeaway message from this study is that people are very different and will use very different strategies to deal with issues like that. So, for example, in which one was it? In E and F, in these scenarios, and probably also in A, it wouldn't be possible to use something like the micro rolls, which we just talked about, because you have too little grip on the device, for example, or you're actually holding the interfering object and still trying to use your thumb, so that might complicate things. Again, this isn't so much about this specific study, but as a takeaway message, I guess it's important to keep in mind that there are even more different possible contexts than there are people, and there are already a lot of very different people, so it's often necessary to kind of design for the lowest common denominator, because if you use some kind of really highly complex interface, then that might only work in very specific contexts, and as soon as you switch to some different context, just because the person has to hold a car key or something, I don't know, then your interface breaks down, basically. All right.